Welcome everybody to our new Friend of the Sea webinar. My name is Mario Passoni and I'm the scientific officer at Friend of the Sea. With me today there will be a super special guest that is already connected, that is Mr. Glenn. Hi Glenn.
Hello everybody, I'm Glenn. It's my pleasure to be here. Thank you Mario for inviting.
Our pleasure too. Who is Friend of the Sea? Friend of the Sea, first of all, belongs to the World Sustainability Organization and is an international program of certification of products from sustainable aquaculture and fisheries activities. We have certified over 1,000 companies from more than 100 countries worldwide. And Friend of the Sea has a kind of sister that is Friend of the Earth, that is the equivalent, but is certifying products from sustainable agriculture and farming. So, what is the subject of today, of our webinar? Today we are going to talk about sharks, about their threats, their status, something about their biology, and we would like to, let's say, summarize level is the conservation status of the sharks and what is the connection with fishing activities. And that's why we have invited one of our main certified companies, that is Frabel. And Mr. Glenn, of course, is from Frabel. And at the end of the webinar, we will explain how they do manage sharks during fishing activities. So, let's start, and we will start from the shark biology. Honestly, there should be so much to say about sharks biology, but I just wanted to summarize something and say something that is very interesting about sharks. First of all, sharks, shark group is very old, really, really old. I think that they have existed from over 40 million years, and they are a very, very old group. They are cartilaginous fish and they belong to the elasmobranch group, the same of the ray, for example. As you probably know, they are predators at the top of the food chain. They are apex predator, so they are very, 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 very important for the entire marine ecosystem. Other fact about shark, they can have more than 10,000 teeth in their entire life. That doesn't mean that they have 10,000 teeth at the same time. They can replace a tooth when it's lost. So the teeth are continuously growing and they can replace them. And they are arranged in usually 2-3 rows, as you can see in this picture. These are teeth. And what is very particular is that every species has a different shape of tooth. So if you find the tooth of a shark, you can understand to which species belong. And here on the left, I put this image just to let you understand how can be different the shape of the teeth of the sharks. And then they have a kind of super sense, the electroreception. What does it mean? It means that they have some organs that are called Lorenzini ampulles that you can see here highlighted by this red circle, this small holes, thanks to which they can feel the electric field of their prey. And this is an hunting strategy in order to improve their hunting strategies. And in this picture, we can see a beautiful tiger shark. Then, their exact number of living sharks is unknown. For sure, we know that there are more than 482 sharks existing now. And the number is still increasing. and hopefully it will increase in the next year. The biggest one that is actually the biggest fish at all is the whale shark, that can reach almost 20 meters in length. If I'm not wrong, the biggest one has been found in Taiwan and was 19 meters 0.9, something like this. simply amazing. And the average of the length of this shark usually is, for the adult, is 12 meters. So if you find a shark, a whale shark of 20 meters, is a kind of exception. The smallest is the dwarf lantern shark, which is long something like 20 centimeters. So it's a, there is a very, 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 very huge difference. And the fastest is the short fin mako, that can swim faster than 50 kilometers per hour. That is incredible. It's incredible. Okay. In this picture, we can see the dwarf lantern shark. So now let's talk about the shark status. The UCN has listed part of the sharks under its red list. What is the red list of the UCN? It's a list where are listed, animals that are threatened with a risk of extinction. And they have created a kind of different classification in order to clarify how endangered are these species. So if we focus on the third row of sharks, we have classified 482 different species of sharks, of which 79 are listed as threatened. Threatened, what does it mean? That they belong to these three categories: critically endangered, endangered, and vulnerable. So here we can see that 10 of them are critically endangered, 20 are endangered, and 49 are vulnerable. These are the worst classification, because it means that they are close to the extinction risk. Then there are 55 species near threatened, and 150 of them least concern. But what is impressive, at least by my side, my point of view, is that 198 species are data deficient. So that means that we do not have data, enough data, by our side to say that if these species are threatened or not. And this can be a very huge incentive in order to spend some research and studies to find out their status. In the detail, more than 30% of the sharks, shark species and their relative, that means race mainly, assessed by the International Union for Conservation of Nature, the UCN, are threatened with extinction. So here I just listed some species, some of them, to give you an idea about their status. The great white shark is considered, is classified as vulnerable. I have read somewhere that in the last 50 years, the global population of white shark has declined of something like the 90%, or 90 or 95, but is impressive in any case. Then the basking shark is classified as endangered, the dusky shark as vulnerable, the sand tiger shark as vulnerable, the scalloped hammerhead endangered, and the whale shark as endangered. So let's summarize which are the most the main threats for sharks. Consider that every year, and this is an estimation, of course, around 100 million, and I repeat, 100 million of sharks are killed by human activities. Which are these activities? The most impacting is the shark finning, and then we will talk deeply about it. Consider that the shark finning kills almost 73 million sharks per year. So the 73%, I would say, but still is an estimation, but still we are talking about millions of sharks every year. Then there is the bycatch, the impact of the ghost fishing gear. And here I have listed something that is not a direct consequence, let's say, but is really strictly related to the shark population, that is overfishing of their prey. So what does it mean? It means that in the last years, due to overfishing, due to illegal fishing activities, the number of the prey of the sharks has decreased dramatically. And of course, as you can easily understand, if there are no prey, sharks that cannot survive. So this is something that we have to keep in mind, because it's something not direct, but is very, 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 very important. So what is the global market of sharks for fins and other parts like meat? There is, of course, a global market for shark fins and meat. Consider that more than, and this number is impressive by my side, 600,000 metric tons of sharks and ray each year between 2007 and 2017 has been sold and consumed. Indonesia, Spain, India, Mexico, and the United States are the main consumers, with an average of 333, almost 34,000 metric tons every year. And the shark finning, what is the shark finning? We were talking about shark finning. It's the practice of removing fins and discarding the carcass, usually pertaining to sharks. So what does it mean? They fish, for example, hammerhead shark. They remove the fins, the pectoral, the dorsal fins, and so on, while are still alive, and they throw literally into the water again the shark, often still alive, and they use only this fin. And this is a terrible practice, a really terrible practice. And there is a lot of illegal shark finning practices around the world. So the global market for shark fins. Shark fin imported. I have taken this data from a recent study made in 2019. Shark fin imported 16,000 metric tons per year from 2000 to 2016. This is an average data. So 16,000 metric tons. The value of this market is around, is almost 300 USA dollars million per year. The main importers are Hong Kong with an average of 9,000 metric tons per year, then Malaysia, China, and Singapore. And the major exporter producer are Spain, Indonesia, Taiwan, and Japan. And below here, we can see a picture of the dorsal fin of some sharks. Used, what is the use of this fin? Is for the shark fin soup that we can see here in this picture. The shark fin soup is used especially for as a tradition for special events, especially in China, Southeast Asia, especially, for example, is a tradition for the weddings. So during a wedding, you have to serve this soup. And this is by my side, really crazy, but what to say. With regards to the shark meat, the global market is the following. The main importers are Brazil, Spain, Uruguay, and Italy. And collectively, they account an average of 57% of global shark meat imports. Okay, here we have an infographic that we have made, if I'm not wrong, last year. And it's very useful because it's summarizing the situation of the shark finning around the world. Why we have created this infographic? Because last year we have found out something that for us was really surprising and impressive. So you have to know that we are based in Milano, and my boss has found out that a delivery company, I think more than one, like Deliveroo, Just Eat, and others, were selling and promoting the shark fin soup in Milano. And it was, wow, how is possible? So we have created a petition in order to ask to Deliveroo and the other delivery companies in Milano, and not only, to stop to sell these products. And we were successful at the end. And was very important for us because it was, at least by my side, was unbelievable to think that in Milano was possible to order with a simple click a shark fin soup and get it at home. Was incredible. Okay, then another huge threat is the bycatch. Bycatch, what is bycatch? Part of the catch of a fishing unit taken incidentally in addition to the target species. I will make a practical example in order to better understand what is bycatch. If there is a fishery and this fishery is targeting on, let's say, mackerels, and is using, for example, purse seine nets, this fishery targets only mackerels. But can happen that into the net can be catching catch also the other species like sea turtles, anchovies, and even sharks. So the non-target species are listed as bycatch, and then the bycatch can be released if possible. And then Mr. Glenn will provide us with a useful example about it. Some statistics, some data. Only in the Pacific Ocean, around 3.3 million sharks are caught each year as bycatch on long line. Long lines are usually used to catch, for example, swordfish. So there is this bait with the hooks, and the sharks can hit the bait and get a catch. The most affected species regarding bycatch are the blue, the hammerhead, the mako, the thresher, and the great white shark. And here in this picture, we can see one of the most endangered species of shark, that is the treasure shark, that is easily recognizable because it has this very long tail. Okay, then there is another threat that is not only, unfortunately, about the sharks, but is that are the ghost fishing nets. So what is a ghost gear? Any fishing gear that is abandoned, lost, or discarded in the marine environment. So to let you better understand, if a fishery is using, again, for example, purse seine net, and is losing for some reason this net, the net will floating at the sea for many months, even years. And while floating, can entangle different species like seabirds, like sharks, sea turtles, cetacean like whales, dolphins, and so on. And this is a terrible threat for them. Because, for example, if a shark or a dolphin is entangled in a ghost fishing net, if it's not released quickly, will die. Another data that is so impressive is the number of tons of fishing gear lost annually worldwide. That is from 640,000 to 800,000 tons of fishing gear every year. And please consider something that mostly the fishing nets are made by a material that can be plastic or similar to plastic. So there is this data that is really impressive, that at least 10% of the plastic pollution floating in our oceans are coming from the fishing gear lost annually. It's incredible. For this reason, for example, we actively cooperate with an international association that is called GGGI, Global Ghost Gear Initiative, in order to reduce this impact. And we have developed recently new requirements in our first wide standard for fishing activities, where we require to reduce this huge impact. And recently, I want to enunciate it, Frabel has been certified for this new standard. Actually, it's the very first one, and I would like to give my compliments to them for this achievement. Then, international conservation legislation. There are different legislation around the world, but there is not yet a global legislation for the conservation of the sharks. For example, in 2010, the United States of America issued the Shark Conservation Act. That is basically quite simple in what is requiring. They do not allow shark finning for the USA fisheries. So it's prohibited, straight and simple, apparently. And then there is a conservation management measure, CMM, for sharks in PNG that ensure the long-term conservation and sustainable use of sharks in fishery activities. I don't want to go too much in the detail about it because it's an argument that will be discussed by Glenn later. Then, the development of shark watching tourism. We have put this section because is a market, is a trend that is increasing rapidly every year. So we wanted to talk a little bit about this new kind of tourism. So what is a shark tourism? Shark watching tourism is when a person is going in a certain place just to dive or snorkel with sharks. The easiest example at all can be shark cage diving that is made mainly in Mexico, Guadalupe Island, in South Africa, and in Australia. And as you can see in this picture that I have put here, people is inside the cage and can watch the sharks, the white sharks mainly, coming closer. So regarding shark watching tourism, that is not only related to shark diving, cage diving, sorry, generated in 2013 a global revenue of more than $300 million. That is quite impressive. In 2017, only Indonesia have been spent $22 million for shark tourism. And this is a very recent research made by one of our scientific committee member, Ika, but I don't know if he's following us, but I would like to thank. And then what to say about the shark watching Turing is that the trend is increasing. So every year, despite what happened during this last year, the number of persons that are going to dive or snorkel, finally swimming with sharks is increasing. I would love to say just the last thing about shark watching tourism. Usually most of the people is scared about sharks, swimming with sharks. Oh no, it's dangerous. please consider that the number of attacks of sharks to human is very low, and the number of yearly victim of shark attacks is around from 5 to 10 person per year. It's a very, 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 very low number. And but of course, you have always to be careful, because since they are apex predator and they are wild creatures, you never know. But most of the time, they usually do not care about you. Then conservation initiatives. Even here, there are so many conservation initiatives about sharks. I've just listed one, because I'm pretty familiar with this initiative, because I took part with it. And is a conservation initiative made by a Mexican society that is called Pelagios Cacunja, or Cacunha, sorry for my pronouns, which one of the co-founder and director is Mauricio Padilla, one of the most important white shark researcher around the world. I'm giving you this information because I took part to these initiatives and was in Mexico in the Revillagigedo archipelago. So the activities were to understand the movement partners, the inter-island connectivity and residency of sharks and rays using acoustic and satellite telemetry. So what did we do? Basically, we target the sharks using this equipment, satellite equipment, and with a special spear, something like this, the researcher mainly target the sharks, as you can see here on the dorsal fin. In this way, it was possible and is possible to understand their movement. Okay, and what was really, really interesting is that was possible to discover that sharks living usually around the Revillagigedo archipelago islands were moving to other islands, for example, to Guadalupe Island, always in Mexico. That is far, something like 300 kilometers, something like this. And why is so important this data? Because if you can confirm that there is a kind of route, of migration route, of endangered and protected species of sharks, you can create marine protected areas in order to preserve and save these sharks. So this is just one of the examples of conservation initiatives. And then one conservation initiatives that we have created recently is about whale sharks. In my previous career, let's say, I was a guide, and while I was bringing often guests to swim with whale sharks. And during those years, I have seen things that I hope to do not see anymore. People touching the whale sharks and disturbing them so much. So we have created a certification standard for tour operators that wants to interact sustainably with whale sharks in order to reduce as much as possible the impact that is coming from wrong human activities with whale sharks. I don't want to spend too much time on this, but of course, if you have questions, if you want to know more about this project, just write us. You can even find this project listed on our website. Okay, so now my initial part is over, and I would like to pass the microphone to Glenn.
Okay, hello everybody. I am Glenn Macias. I am the Fleet and Operations Manager now for Fradal PNG Limited. I am based in Ley City, Papua New Guinea. I will introduce to you our shark good handling management for Fradal Fishing and Fradal PNG Limited. Our fleet is operating in Papua New Guinea, and Fradal Fishing Corporation responded to the call for the development of domestic tuna fishery in Papua New Guinea by establishing Fradal PNG Limited in Ley, Papua New Guinea in 1989. Fradal PNG acquired its first tuna porcine vessels in 1998. Today, our fishing activities continue to grow by acquiring, chartering additional vessels and improving the tuna fish exports of Papua New Guinea with the state-of-the-art technologies and sustainable fishing practices combined with social and environmental responsiveness. Our fleet targeted tuna are skipjack, yellowfin, and big eye tuna, and unloaded to our onshore facilities. So this is our picture in Papua New Guinea with our wharf and the factory. Okay. Our fishing operations. Our fleets are operating in Papua New Guinea on its EEZ zone and PNG AW. All catches are recorded accordingly, included our bycatch. So one of the bycatch associated in the school of fish is shark. So shark are usually associated with the school of fish and feed with the small fish. Under legislation and conservation, WCPFC CMM, this is what Sir Mario was discussing a while ago, 2003-08.02, that CMM states that CMM shall require all vessels flying their flag and vessels under charter arrangements to the CMM to release any silky shark that is caught in the convention area as soon as possible after the shark is brought alongside to the vessel, and not to make any little harm of the shark as possible. Sorry. Also, PNG National Fisheries implements the CMM and monitored 100% NFA observer on board in all licensed vessels in Papua New Guinea. Okay, this is the observer. We have a picture of the observer on board the vessel doing all his duties. Okay. Any shark unintentionally caught were discarded as soon as possible. So discards are listed on the SPC FFA log sheets and is confirmed by captain and verified by the authority. So I will show you a big picture of this SPC FFA regional porcine log sheet. On the red box, this is the discard area where we indicate and encode the silky shark. If we caught unintentionally, we have to put how many of them, and then the weight also. And on that day, we have all the activities of the school associated codes here. We input all that one. So once the vessel arrives at port, NFA officer will verify all these documents and then stamp here and sign. So we have the NFA officer, and also vessel captain will verify and confirm that particular documents. Apart from that, Fradal PNG and Fradal Fishing Corporations have its own anti-shark finning policy. So we have the anti-shark finning policy posted on the vessel, and we let the crew aware on that one, on the consequences if they are involved on shark commercials and tradings. So we have also incorporated this one on our code of discipline or our code of conduct, that anybody of the crew or anybody of the employers that are involved in catching sharks for commercial purposes or any other purposes of catching sharks should be dismissed or terminated. So we have all this one in our system now with Fradal. And then Fradal now is embracing on this sustainable and responsible fishing management. So we invited some experts to do vessel crew training. And currently, we are going forward on how to improve the crew's welfare, food safety, the marine litter and fishing gear management. I'm very proud to inform you that we are on the second phase now on our marine litter and fishing gear management. Hopefully by the end of this quarter, we are able to finish all the documentations and observations on our gaps within the operation, and fully, hopefully we can fully implement this marine litter and fishing gear management by the first quarter of 2021. And then also Frabel also now improving and their documentations on reduce, reuse, recycle for plastic on board the vessel. So we have our experts who help us, the Seafood Matter. They are the one helping us on this, on how to improve the system for Frabel to have to maintain and to be part of the campaign on the sustainable and responsible fishing management. Frabel now is certified by BRC IFS, Dolphin Safe Certificate, the Earth Island Institute, and Friend of the Sea. We have MSC also, and BSCI. So moving forward, I'll show you the pictures on how Frabel managed their shark when they caught it at sea, and we have to release it at sea after they are entangled on the nets. Next picture, same. If there are large sharks that are entangled, we release them at sea. And I will show you a 1 minute video, less than 1 minute video for your reference also, and how we release the shark at sea. Okay, that's it, and thank you everyone. I'll transfer again to Sir Mario on.
Okay, excellent, thank you very much. Before concluding my presentation, I just want to start a poll in which, I've started. We have a question for all of you. What do you think is the best solution to protect sharks? Create marine protected areas, regulate fishing activities of fisheries, ban shark finning, promote sustainable shark tourism. So I already see that some of you are voting. Okay. Okay, later at the end we will see the... wow, you are so reactive, bravi. Okay, so I will share again my screen. So to conclude, I have listed some possible solutions in order to preserve the sharks. As you have understood, sharks are fundamental for our ecosystem. Even if we do not get into the water, is fundamental to preserve the entire ecosystem, to regulate its inhabitants. So we have a list of possible solutions. The first point is responsible consumption. So what does it mean? For example, avoid to eat shark fin soup, for example. Sustainable tourism. To choose only tour operators that are sustainable, listed as sustainable, and then are not promoting invasive practices like touching the sharks or feeding the sharks, depends, and so on. Responsible trade, again, responsible trade. So following all the international rules and avoiding to trade species that are threatened with risk of extinction. Create marine protected areas for sharks. In this way, sharks can breed and increase their number. And then at the end, but not less important than others, make research, awareness, as we are doing now, and education. These are the possible solutions. Of course, I want to hear from you if you think there are other possible solutions. So now is questions and answer time. Here I have listed two links, one to our Shark campaign and petition, and the other one to our Whale Shark Watching project. Don't worry, we will send you the PowerPoint, so you will find these links. So, are you ready, Glenn? Because maybe there are questions for you. Okay. So, okay. A person is asking, from your slide, the United States is one of the main sources of shark fins. Isn't it illegal to do shark finning in the United States? Yes, but you have to know that there is a huge illegal market behind fishing activities. I give you another example. For example, in the Mediterranean and Adriatic Sea, so close to Italy, there are a lot of rules, conservation measures to be followed. And there are in place, and they are very good, very, very, very good. The real problem for the stocks of the fish, especially in the Adriatic Sea, is the illegal fishing activities that is unregulated. So a fisherman that is respecting all the rules is in difficulty because the stocks are decreasing, for example. Then we have another question. Is it possible to undergo induced breeding or artificial insemination of selected shark species? Good question. I don't know. No, really, I don't know, but I can tell you that it could be something very complicated, because can be maybe a solution, but once you think to start a project like this, you have to always to keep in mind that you have to keep as high as possible the genetic diversity of the species. So I think it's something very complicated. Ben, another question. Do you have studies regarding shark bycatch statistic in tuna per seine operation in the Pacific Ocean? Species release data, live, dead, etc. and so on. No, but I can look for it. So, shark bycatch statistic in tuna. I can look for it. You can write us, and I will try to gather some information. You can write me here. I will reply to your question. My email is quality@friendofthesea.org. So please write me. I will do my best to find an answer. Ben. How realistic is to ban shark finning? Regarding the MPA, marine protected areas, they are good, a good solution if enforced properly. Are there any suggestions on how to enforce marine protected areas? Okay, so we have two questions here. Of course, Glenn, when you want to say something, you can interrupt me.
Okay, sir.
How realistic is to ban shark finning? Can be realistic, but I think we will never stop at all this. Okay, it's like for the elephant ivory. I mean, you can reduce as much as possible, but then there will be always somebody that will pay so much to have, in this case, a fin for a soup. And so we can attack, we can reduce, but of course more strictly straight rules are needed. It's not easy because it's since 2015 that I hear about shark finning, and I don't know how much salt we achieved up to now. I think that, for example, there was a kind of yes, a video to create awareness in Hong Kong with a famous Chinese basketball player. I don't remember the name, and was at the restaurant. And this restaurant, there was this aquarium where sharks without fins were swimming. Okay, and he refused to eat his shark fin soup, and everybody in this video were after him, refusing to eat this soup. Only with this video, the consumption of shark finning has been reduced at that time of 80%. I don't know if now has increased again, but it's something really complicated. Regarding your second question regarding the marine protected areas, yeah, I agree that they are a good solution, and they I think that only by monitoring constantly the marine protected areas, we can achieve real results. So is the only way. Okay. Another question. Is there...
Okay. Just an additional suggestions on the previous question with those statistics in porciners, mm-hmm. where we can check if what are those discards, how many alives and how many deads. Currently, Frabel is a member of the FIA, the Fishing Industry Association of Papua New Guinea. I would raise this. I will lobby this to the association to include on their monitoring and documentations on the shark discards, because currently on the SPC it's only the quantity and the numbers, but there's no information there if they are dead or alive. So I think it's a help for us after this webinar. I can suggest to the association to help us on these statistics also for your reference.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
Okay, so yeah, just two more questions, and then I will show you the result of the poll. Is there any specific wise preference for shark fins? No, I don't think so. What I know is that, for example, the fins of the whale sharks are not that much appreciated. Some whale sharks are killed for the fins, but it's not considered as the best solution at all. If I'm not wrong, the most attacked by this side is the skull of the hammerhead shark. Then, what must one do to work in the same field as you are? Is something back to the ocean. this is something, it's not easy to reply to this. Maybe you can write me privately and we can discuss about it. What about the basking sharks? Are they fins popular too? No, I never heard about it, luckily. Okay, let's say the last one. For Glenn, do you also release animals using two crew members, one holding each?
Yes, for Miss Trixie. Okay. yes. We usually depends on the situation, but since on the mindset of the crew, since shark, they always think that it will bite, so. Sometimes we, if it's small, depend on the size. If depend on the size, then we can release the animals using. If it's bigger size, then we can use two members. That's the one that awareness that also that we are going to raise to the crew when it comes to releasing of the shark, because some things that they are afraid to hold the shark, some are brave enough to hold the shark. So I think for now, we have to raise also an awareness that depending on the size of the shark, then if it's only small, then one crew member can release the shark. And then the other, if it's bigger, then two members can release the shark.
Grazie, Glenn. Grazie. Grazie. Okay, the last one, and then we conclude. Is it illegal to engage in shark finning in the world? But there are shark meat or dried shark meat available in the market. So, are all the products available in the market from illegal sources? No, depends. For example, we have to distinguish shark meat from the fins. For example, in Italy, you can find shark meat at the supermarket, for example, but you cannot find the fins at the supermarket. In some restaurants are sold. So it's not easy for me to answer completely to your question because depends by every state. So it's difficult. Okay. Okay, so let's see the result of the poll. We got 43 votes. And the winner is to the question, what do you think is the best solution to protect sharks? The 42% of you voted regulate fishing activities of fisheries. I agree. Even if all the other answers are important. Okay. Perfect. So, thank you very much, everybody, for following this webinar. Unfortunately, I didn't answer to all the questions, but again, if you want to contact me privately at quality@friendofthesea.org, I will be glad to answer you. Okay? Okay. Glenn, thank you very much.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much. My pleasure.
I will wait for your official invitation to come and visit you in Papua New Guinea.
You're welcome here.
Thank you very much. And thanks, everybody. Have a nice day.
Thank you, sir.
Bye.
Bye-bye.